as less evolved simply because of their size. Completely dizzy thing. Go the same side every time. But apart from these long wings, you'll also note they've got a nice long tail as well. And this is what they use to actually hover. Yeah, I thought you'd miss it there. This is what they use to go ahead of me. Don't dare sneak up behind me. Okay. This is what they use to hover out to the wild. Okay, it's a great way of actually being able to find roads. Yeah, I'm not going to do too much there, are we? It's not true that they're the only birds of prey to do it, but they have got it incredibly well polished. They've got lots of fine art, and it gives them a great view into the grass beneath them, and they're looking for rodents. Their eyesight is obviously very advanced, just as all the raptors are, but they're particularly good at looking into the ultraviolet range, which means that they can see a glowing trail of urine behind this rodent, because these rodents are actually incontinent, okay? And they follow that trail right to the end. They see where the rodent is, and when it sticks its head out of the grass, they come down and strike it like so. Good girl. Okay. So I'm not great. She was pretty warm out after yesterday by the looks of it. But I still think she deserves a little round of applause for her effort. Now she's come in and she's hit that there just as she put a rodent, and then she's immediately brought it to me. Now she's not actually bringing it to me. Okay. She's actually carrying out a natural behaviour. It's just a behaviour that you very rarely, if ever, I've never seen it before, with a bird of prey actually exhibiting it to a human. Okay. Now this is a behaviour called carrying. Okay. And it's exactly what she would do in the wild. All birds of prey do it when they're on the ground, just not to people. I am a hedge right now. That's what I am. Okay. And she's basically just carrying it under something, sometimes into long grass, under a tree, under a hedge. Excuse me, and it's just somewhere safe, okay? In the air, she's quite manoeuvrable, she's reasonably quick, she feels quite confident in the air. On the ground is a scary place to be. There could be something like a cat or a fox sneaking up behind you, okay? There could be a bigger bird of prey flying over above and looking down and trying to eat you, okay? So finding somewhere nice and safe where you can drag your prey under, she can then eat it there in peace. Okay, so that's what she's doing, that's the behaviour called carrying. Now, she has, like I say, she has got her food, but she is so small that it actually take her quite a while to actually finish up. So what I'm going to do with her, behind me again, and what I'm going to do today is I'm actually going to take her back into the weighing room where she can eat that in peace and quiet in her own time, and we can move on with our next bird. So we're going to get a very young bird out next, okay, but before we get him out, I think I'll hear just one last little round. Now, I feel sure you'll recognise this bird very quickly as a barn owl, okay? And you kind of proved it once again why we have a certain nickname for barn owls, and that nickname is the R bird, okay? Barn owls appear, and we quite often hear this general R sound, which, like I said, they are very, very pretty birds indeed. And again, another native species. Now this is one that potentially you may very well see on your day-to-day travels. Unlike the kestrel, you won't see this bird out in the middle of the day as such. Generally more the evenings and the mornings. Sometimes night time, but generally more in that sort of twilight zone. Are you struggling with the first bit of food, fella? Sit down. Okay. Now they have many names. Okay, and due to the white coloration, the fact that they're often just flitting by and they're totally silent, one such nickname for them is the ghost owl. They have actually been responsible for an awful lot of ghost stories in the past. Yeah. Now, this particular barn owl, his name's Soren. Okay? Soren here is actually a year old. He's done plenty of flying with us just inside in our lecture theatre. Okay? We have actually been kind of getting him ready to fly outside. And this is actually his second demonstration outside with me. Okay, so he's kind of he's getting used to things, but he's taking it in his stride. He's very, very, very keen. Now, a barn owl's as I said, are birds. Okay, they're generally renowned for being very cute, okay? And I want to balance this statement, because he is very cute, and he is a lovely looking little boy, but he is also a savage hunter, believe it or not, okay? He is incredibly efficient at what he does, and what he does, he's pretty much a specialist rodent hunter. Okay, he'll go out and catch all sorts of small rodents. Now, he is your worst nightmare. He is absolutely your worst nightmare if you are a rodent. Okay? He is perfectly designed for this job. Now, for a start, you won't even see him coming. Okay? The white colour is often... That's an odd colour for a bird of prey. Okay, it's bright white, that surely stick out like a sore thumb. In actual fact, white is an incredibly good colour to camouflage, particularly when you're hunting these rodents. Because these rodents, they don't have the best eyesight in the world. Okay, they look up at the sky and they see the white chest, the white under the wings, and they look up at the sky, so they can't see him. They also cannot hear him coming. Okay, owls, when they're cruising around, they are silent. There's no noise to give Sorrel away either. And he will find you. He's got good eyesight, of course, just as all the birds of prey have, really. But you can't even hide from him either. He also has very good hearing. The facial disc that you see is actually the first stage of a hearing system called asymmetrical hearing, and that is basically a satellite dish bringing all the sound waves bouncing around the environments to his two ears. Okay, now his ears are actually slightly bulbous. And this means that these sound waves hit the ears at slightly different times. It enables, will you let me get away? Okay, it actually enables him to triangulate sound. It enables him to work out exactly where it's coming from with pinpoint accuracy. And he's got no problem at all being able to hear a mouse running around in the grass. Okay, so you cannot run from him. Okay, but you can't see, you can't hear him, you cannot run, you cannot hide. Now, when seen a barn owl, but when you see a barn owl out in the wild, they're quite often quartering or doing little rings about 30 foot above the ground, and he's searching for mice, isn't he? He's searching for these small rodents. Now, when he's found his rodent, okay, he will throw in just a little hover. Okay, he's basically preparing himself to launch downwards. Now, the feet just kind of get brought in towards the body like a spring, preparing. Okay, what he's actually doing, he's actually just twisting his body down. He's going to come down head first, flying directly towards the ground. Now, at the very last seconds, the wings will flare open. Okay, this will obviously slow him, so he doesn't actually crash into the ground, but it also sort of swings his legs forwards. Okay, and when he hits the rodent, he'll actually hit it with both feet. Now, he won't be putting the feet apart, hoping to catch the rodent with one of them. He's going to put all of his eggs into one basket. Okay. He's trying to send this shockwave that he's created right into that rodent. Okay. And when he hits it, he will actually hit it with a force 18 times his own body weight. Okay. That impact will send that shockwave through that rodent. It will break virtually every bone in its body, okay, and kill it on impact. Okay. This is the cute little barn owl that we call the owl bird. Okay. Just because he happens to be very cute to us, doesn't mean he's any less of a bird of prey than any of the others who are very keen today. Now, this, like I said, is one of his first demonstrations. It's his second demonstration, actually, with me outside. I'm not going to actually push him any more than that. I'm not going to push my luck with him. I think he has done a wonderful job for us. If you could be so kind, give him a little round of applause. And we're going to move on to something a little bit bigger. Now, there is a good reason why I've left this bird here. His name's Zeus. Zeus here is a 3-year-old male Chilean blue eagle. Okay? And he can be heart-stoppingly unreliable. Okay? Sometimes he does a really, really good job. Okay? Other times, he just kind of does what he wants. Okay? Now, there is another reason why he's a little shaky with that situation. I'll kind of tell you about that in due course. But more an introduction to what he is. Now, he's a Chilean blue eagle, he's 3 years old, he's fully grown, but he's not fully mature yet. He's still changing his colours. Okay? Now, the Chilean blue eagle is actually native to areas of South America, Chile, for example, but also Brazil, are where you really quite commonly find these birds out in their natural habitat. But they're not always known by a Chilean blue eagle. Okay? Quite often, they're actually called another name, which is the dark-chested or the grey-chested buzzard, sometimes buzzard eagle. Now, the reason for the confusion at the end is because we are really very confused about this bird. We don't actually know what he is. Okay? They're not very well studied out in the wild. There aren't loads of them in captivity. Okay? And he's just weird. He's kind of got eagle parts to him, and he's got buzzard aspects to him. His wing shape is just a bit odd in general. Okay? Classifying this bird is really difficult. They were originally classified as eagles simply due to their size more than their taxonomy. Okay? But more research that's going into it, looking at its shape, etc. Kind of suggests that they're close to deposits, but no one's really sure yet. But it's not too much of an important thing, really. All these groups, all of these categories are just words that we like to put in our head, because they don't actually mean anything out in the wild. Now, Zeus, I can say he's 3 years old now. He's actually been with us ever since he's just turned two. Okay. Now, he's not a rescue bird. He was never abused or mistreated. He's just kind of a second-hand bird, which has his quirks and such. Now, he was actually bred within captivity, and he was bred as part of a future breed program himself. Yeah, it's a very important role. Animals, not just raptors now, but animals that we have in captivity really do serve as an ark as such. It's a genetic gene pool separate from the influences that go on in the wild. Okay? So if anything disastrous happens out there, you can breed, you can release, you can actually reintroduce them. And there are loads of examples of where this has been a great success in the past. In this country, red kites and peregrines, for example, we wouldn't have them without breed and release programs now. And there are lots of other examples all over the world. Now, with Zeus being in this breeding program, as I've mentioned already, there aren't actually a great deal of these birds in captivity. Again, it was proving very difficult to actually find one which wasn't related to his bloodline. Okay, by the time he got to 2 years old, they just couldn't find anything. So they decided the best thing to do for him would be to find him a flying home. So we turned up here and we started work with him. And 2 years old, completely untouched, never seen people before, is not exactly a great start that we want for a demonstration bird. But he does it, as you can see. But we have his sort of twitchy moments. The first headache that we have with Zeus is that he doesn't actually like beef. Okay? Which is not ideal. He works quite well with me, and he will actually work with another member of staff as well. But apart from that, if you're human, he will look on you with great suspicion. Okay? So, that is softening, and that is getting better. Hopefully, give it a few more years, and we won't notice it at all. The second problem that we have with Zeus, in my opinion, the more major problem, is that Zeus is really clumsy. Okay. He's never really had that opportunity to fly properly in his first few years of life, and that's when he was really, that's when he's learning at a rapid rate. Okay. Now, he's kind of got the taking off from the cornering and the landing down to a pretty good tee, okay, but he's struggling with the more complex stuff that we want him to do, and that's soaring. Okay. He may be able to see each time he actually, more when he comes up to land on something, how broad his wings are. He is a broad wing, and we have different shaped wings for different styles of flights, and the broad wings really specialise in soaring. If you see the buzzards, or perhaps red kites while you're out, they're broad wings as well, and they're soaring when you see them. We've got their wings outstretched, not moving a great deal, and they're harnessing environmental lift, be it wind currents, or warm pockets of rising air, called thermals, and they're using them as their energy source to move around, and that's what we want to show Zeus doing. Ken, he is kind of getting there. Some days he looks really, really good at it. Last week, however, he flew into a tree, and did a pile of stinger nettles, and rolled into a pond. we have our good days and our bad days, but the more time he comes out, the more experienced he gets, and slowly but surely, the better he is getting. Okay, so it's kind of work in progress with him. Now, out in the wild, okay, Chile, Brazil, we have these mountainous regions, we have a nice warm climate, so when it's windy, there's lots of wind currents, lots of wind lift, there's mountainous terrain, and when it's not there, we've got thermals. Okay, so growing up in an environment like that, he's going to be a very good soaring bird. Okay, day in, day out, they were getting up to around 4,000 feet, which is pretty impressive, and actually, if you want to classify him as an eagle, it actually makes him the highest flying eagle in South America. Okay, there are various other species, some which are much, much larger than Zeus, but they're forest eagles. They stay in and around the canopy. He goes way above it, and he's using this height as a platform to try and spot food on the ground. Now, they will take birds. When they take birds, it is generally more common, of the limited data that there is on these birds, that they're actually working together, the male and the female, the bonded pair. Now, the female, she is larger, okay, girls are bigger than boys, so she plays the role of destruction, okay? She tail chases the bird, okay, keeping the birds looking over its shoulder, wondering what's coming up behind it, what that shoot straight out of the air. Then they will, of course, share it on the ground later. Now, more commonly, though, they seem to hate things on the ground. Okay? Mammals, reptiles, things like wild hedgehog, wild guinea pig, daegu, mammals up to the size of a grey fox, generally. Now, grey fox are not quite as large as our native red fox, but they're still over twice Zeus's weight, just. Okay? They have a very developed set of jaws on them. He very well may, for example, actually win the battle and kill that particular fox and get his meal for the day, but if he's got a bite, infection sets in, he loses the war. This is not something that they do on a constant basis, and when they do, it's generally the females being the larger, more physically built, physically capable of the two for that challenge. But a quarry that Zeus actually relies on a great deal out in the wild has given him an nickname, okay? And it's not nearly as flattering as the house or two being able to fill the sky. Zeus's nickname is the Stinky Bird. Okay. Now, they call him the Stinky Bird because this quarry, which he relies on so often, happens to be the hog-nosed skunk. Okay. And I think you've worked it out. By the time you've ripped apart a skunk, shoved it down your mouth, they're not going to smell overly nice afterwards. So it's a nickname which is well deserved, but yeah, don't worry, we don't feed aggressive skunks, so we don't replicate that part of your life, do we? Now, Zeus here, he's done a really good job. Still here, so that's great. Now, I think he deserves a round of applause. He deserves very, very well. Now, he is going to be the last bird we're flying in this
Thank you.